the county broken down by township and borough. And I saw really high numbers of free Negroes living in Butler and Manalan Township. And I looked and found it was the second highest population of free Negroes in the county. But I grew up here, and there were hardly any free Negro families that continued to exist.
So I went to the
census to find out who are the people that created the over 100 folks in the summary of the census data in these townships in 1850. So my question was, who were these folks? How did they get here? What did they do while they were here? And when I graduated in 1978 from Biglerville, why weren't their grandchildren among me? When I looked on old maps of 1858 and 1872, which we have, mm-hmm. before and after the Civil War, with property owners, I saw my family, my husband's family, my classmates' family. But the community of Negroes that I found in the census that lived here, their families didn't live here anymore. So that was the mystery. So I wanted to solve the mystery. Who were these folks? I found that Yellow Hill was called Pine Hill originally. Yellow is a term sometimes used to define people of mixed race. And I believe that because of the mulatto family, Ed Matthews and his wife Annie, and their children, that it was renamed from Pine Hill to Yellow Hill. So here in Biglerville, where I grew up, and Gettysburg is where I was born, my grandfather had a fruit farm on Yellow Hill. And on Yellow Hill, I discovered there was a church where African Americans worshiped the Lord, had evangelical camp meetings from the 1840s through the 1890s, and it's where they buried their deceased loved ones, and two soldiers of the American Civil War, the U.S. Colored Troops, were buried at the Yellow Hill Church lot and cemetery. The church was consecrated in 1869, and the folklore of the area is that it was burned down by three white men, according to the local lore, but it seems as though the black community had been dispersing decades before that. The height of the Negro community up here was 1850, less in 1860, less in 1870, and so on. The federal fugitive slave law was increased in 1850, and it's my belief these folks got a little further away from that Mason-Dixon cemetery. We know that Ed Matthews purchased 16 acres in 1842, 14 original acres is in the woods. His house stands in the woods yet today. That property's been transferred. An acre lot in front has been transferred. This property is landlocked, unowned, and untaxed. Here are four corners to the church lot and cemetery. There's a small tree here, corner one, corner two, corner three is, there is another rock pile with a stake in the ground. Corner four is on the other side of the tree with the three white dots. There's a stake in the ground. So this is the church lot and cemetery. Out of his original 16 acres, we've had ground penetrating radar done here. The church was here, and about 20 burials in 1960. And I grew up there, lived there my whole life, didn't know that I was related to the first soldier killed at Gettysburg. This is George Washington Sando. My name growing up was Deb Sando. I was born in Gettysburg, but didn't know about him, so I wanted to delve into his history and learn as much as I could. He was in Robert Bell's Independent Cavalry Company B. He enlisted the 23rd of June, 1863, and was killed on the 26th of June, 1863. His bride, Diana, received a pension. I think she got $12 a month, but it was enough to feed her, to sustain her and her young son. It's believed that she had a son and named him Charles Grant. Now, George was 20 years old when he met his early death. Confederates came to Gettysburg June 26th. I tell his story using the ladies' diaries. They all talk about the fear that the people of Gettysburg had when the rebels invaded. And they mentioned the darkies are skedaddling. When I researched George's death on June 26th, some of the women were saying in their diaries about the black citizens fleeing the area and the fear that they had. Confederates coming to your town meant a death sentence for some of these free Negroes. They knew they were taking them off the streets as contraband of war in Chambersburg and Waynesboro. We read about that in Gettysburg newspapers. Now, I recently learned through this picture that my great-grandfather and great-great-grandfather were picking apples with these Quakers that I'm talking about on this Underground Railroad tour. I grew up as a Methodist. I'm a converted Quaker, but this picture was recently given to me. Ralph Sando, Henry P. Sandow, and among here are some relatives of some of these Quakers who were freedom fighters in the Underground Railroad. This was probably taken in the late 1800s. And again, I wrote this book on a building named after one of these Eldon sons. Grand Army of the Republic was a veterans organization created with the purpose of getting veterans a pension. There were GAR halls where they held their meetings. There were five in Adams County. There was one in Bendersville named after these sons. Quakers, early on, but buried here as Lutherans. Here's mom and dad, Elizabeth and Robert. And from the symbols, we know this is the willow tree, the tree of everlasting life, depicting life in heaven. A book, the Holy Bible, letting you know these are Christian people. Here are their sons. Their son Thomas, son of Robin and Elizabeth. Member, he was a sergeant, Company G, 138th Pennsylvania Volunteers. Died June 7th, 1864 of wounds received at the Battle of the Wilderness. Do you know how most men died at the Battle of the Wilderness?
I'd say disease.
They burnt to death. They could not get the wounded off the field. The trees caught fire. They said the shrieks of the dying men were horrendous. Men crying for water and crying for the names of their wives and sweethearts and their mothers. This is Joseph, son of Robert and Elizabeth, corporal, not private, sergeant and corporal. 209th Pennsylvania Volunteers killed at the battle near Petersburg, Virginia. When did the war end? April of 65. When did he die? April 2nd, 1865, within a week of the end of the American Civil War. Here they come. When you can't talk about your differences and you stop talking and you bear arms against each other, the result is death. So I tell people the lesson here is tact and diplomacy. Talk about your differences. The result is not good otherwise.
The famous captive that we have in Adams County is Mary Jemison. If you ever get into the French and Indian War, this is a story that is just incredible. She was kidnapped when she was about 15 or 16. Her family was slaughtered. She lived with Native Americans her whole life. Wrote her account of it by a local doctor in New York, James Seaver. The narrative of the life of Mary Jemison was published in the early 1800s. It's been reprinted many times, and there's a monument in this county to her.